Well, that's the question people would generally ask, you know. And there's a lot of good reasons. For instance, one possible reason. Yes, I'll say it. Some of us have the same answer for this. One answer of that is, well, I was a furry before I was a brony, so I know all about After Dark.
That's a really short furry.
That's a really short furry. Well, there was one point on, I was actually on Reddit, on a subreddit that I like called Clopfic. And wrote an elaborate answer for this, which I think makes a lot of sense. For instance, one reason the ponies get to us in this way is their parts are super rounded and contoured because Flash makes these curves with control points, and the forms that it makes, they mimic the contour of things like mammaries and posteriors. I actually even wrote stronger words than that there, but since the roast of MLP went so horribly wrong, we're all kind of a little gun-shy here. I watch it for the plot.
What's a plot?
You know, these shapes are neither geometric or they're irregular. They're sort of idealized, you know, shapes. And so the ponies are really appealing to the eye. More importantly than that, they have really striking, clear personalities. You know, when we look at these ponies and it's like, okay, it's just a cartoon, how come you're having this reaction to it? It's not just because the appearance of it is just an empty, hollow shell for gratification. You know, these are like people we know. You know, it's like sweet nerdy Twilight or the awesome and amazing Rainbow Dash. You know, these are not empty images. They're filled with character. That's actually good. You know, how many people spend a lot of time, you know, alone with a tissue and a bunch of lotion, looking at just images that don't even have any personalities to them. It's kind of dehumanizing and stuff. And the ponies we can relate to. We like them. We love them.
Some more than others.
Some more than others. It's not hard to imagine how each of these ponies would play along with the kinds of things we're imagining and to keep on imagining it step by step. So it's all very interesting in that way. You know, and because these are not a mass of pointless detail, the images and the characterization are all sort of iconic and simple and basic. You really understand them easily and you get them. It leaves you a lot of room to
play.
But I know I just wrote, it leaves you a lot of room to fill in the gaps with yourself. Your personality is part of what animates these ponies. It's like the way you're filling in and creating your own, like Rainbow Dash or whatever, every artist or fantastic writer ends up creating their own versions of these characters. They all come out a little bit differently. Like, you know, my main cast is not the same as O's main cast. It's not the same as Slipkiss's main cast. You know, and all of you create your own ponies in whatever ways you interact with the ponies as well. You're getting to create your own dream Twilight or Applejack or Dashie or whatever without getting lots of argument from the real ones contradicting you.
Which is actually one of the reasons why I got into it, because I was actually sort of writing in the early days of FIM. And the thing is, in those early days, there weren't a lot of fanfics, so I was kind of reading them all, and some of them were getting, you know, a little out there, a little crazy, and I was all like, you know, could I do that too?
Yes.
I mean, some of these are pretty poor, so I think I can beat that. Yeah. Not like that. But, you
know. So beat that, yeah.
You know, I figured it'd be a new challenge, a new experience, experiment if you will. And turned out to be a lot of fun.
Oh yeah. We're gonna try to dig into some of the secrets of writing good pop fiction. We're looking into. Was I supposed to say that word? Oh.
Whoops.
We're gonna try to look into
some things.
That's actually not one of the seven naughty words. We're thinking about trying to get into some of the secrets of how to write this stuff and have people be interested in it. Does that sound good? Like, you know, what's working for us kind of thing?
Yeah.
Pretend like you like it.
Well, maybe that's one of the secrets.
Yeah.
Oh.
Fake it till you make it.
Okay, well,
we did attack and then get Equestria.
Interested in one of the first notions we came up with when we were brainstorming them on what we're going to say? We're thinking that good writing runs on the character desires, especially when the desires are blocked or go wrong. It's not really about like, oh, and this is the one in which I go to Equestria as a brony and meet Rainbow Dash, who randomly wants to go to bed with me and blah, 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 blah. Instead, it's about the character desires and coming up with ways we're talking about that, and you can say, okay, so the plot is Rainbow Dash suddenly has this strong desire, you know, not like she would ever have strong desires in the fix that we tend to write.
Surely not.
Never. But rather, you set up, you know, you address it like it was writing a regular story, writing regular drama, in that you might have something going on, oh, it's wonderful with this kind of stuff. You might have something going on where they have some conflict. Something is being attempted, but it's not necessarily going to go right because some pony in the story is having a problem with some part of it and they've got to work through it.
Right. I mean, you know, things don't always work out perfectly in the bedroom, and, you know, that is can be a major source of drama because, you know, you have two people whose emotions are running very high, and for something to go wrong at that point can echo in ways that are larger than just a fight outside of the bedroom.
Oh yeah. Oh yeah.
Were we allowed to say sex? I don't remember.
You might as well. We're going to have to work out a way to do this because we got cleared from the council. We are allowed to have this panel. We just have to come up with a way of doing it effectively so we can fit into a PG-13 convention, and we'll do our level best. Yes, say sex. Say it again.
Sex. Okay. Say it again.
Sex. Okay,
so, this is just from my personal experience, but, I have never had a...
Point your microphone at you because you're no longer wearing the horse mask.
Oh, yeah, I'm no longer wearing the horse mask. Okay. So, you can do something that's just, flawless textbook, what you would see on, produce work, I guess. I'm no longer on VHS, apparently, but anyway. But you can do that, but, in a way, that's kind of boring. I honestly think that, a little bit of, clumsiness is kind of interesting, because, well, don't do that because I'm not into that, or, this is what I'm into, and let me show you how to do it. You kind of have more interaction and chemistry that way, because...
Realism.
Yeah, realism. Yeah. That makes it more fun, I guess. So, a little mistake here and there. It's kind of interesting. Spice things up in the bedroom.
And not to mention, it's an exploration of the kind that you will not get in the show.
Yep.
Simply put, we're not going to see this in the show. The horses,
well, we can
not look at another horse and go yeah. So this is your chance to show folks, this is how you view, say, Pinkie Pie and insert pony that you ship Pinkie Pie with.
And a big tub of pudding.
Exactly. And say, okay, how would this actually go with their personalities? How's this gonna, are they gonna mesh? Are they gonna mesh right away? Are they gonna mesh that way? And, you know, just really explore the character and make a statement about them.
Yeah, it's some of the strongest, most basic desires are sexual desires. It's a completely, through history, there's always been a lot of fiction that's gone into those areas, and it's always run into challenges. Like Stanley Kubrick's last film, Eyes Wide Shut, is a big exploration of sexual conflicts. And he had a lot of challenges in producing it and putting it out and getting critical attention for it for that exact reason. He was diving into this, hot topic area, and yet he considered that worth talking about. These are interesting areas to explore. These are some of the strongest positions that you can do drama from. And that is a really important reason to not just settle for I'm going to just play and do simple self-gratification and pandering. And think of what acts do a generic audience, what acts will such an audience want to read about, and then having done them, the story just ends and stuff. It can get so much more interesting than that. The emotions can get so much more engaged than that. And the scenarios can get so much more tangled than that when they start tapping into these very deep, basic drives.
Because really, if you rush things and just only worry about pleasing yourself, all you're going to be left with is a mess. Oh wait, that was not a long time ago.
Whoops. But it's really an art form, like any other art form that you would attempt. Like, the final product should be satisfying not only to you, but to your audience. Otherwise, it's basically, there's no point in even attempting it, because who else is going to look at it besides you? But some people do that, but whatever. So like, they just have to be like, really, I don't know what I'm going with this.
It's okay, I can pick up there. I mean, no, it is true. As they're going on and on. Yeah, I'm sorry. Share the mic here. Do my best with this.
Yeah, see, like I said, we already have kind of too many people up on the stage, so we're doing a little bit.
Making it work.
Making it work.
You know, psychosexual desires are fertile ground for stories and have been through the history of literature, but at its core, it's really no different than writing any other story, especially stories with action. A lot of people compare writing sexual action to writing violent action. It's easy to write a rote kind of description of physical things going on, but that oftentimes doesn't give you the most compelling thing to read. What you really want to be focusing on is the overarching story, is motivations between characters, why they're doing what they're doing, and what it means to them rather than what they're doing.
Right, I mean, one of the things I kind of thought of when I was thinking about this panel is that sex in itself is actually a story. You go from characters wanting something to a climax, and then... But it's also a really boring story. It's one that everyone knows the beginning, middle, and end to. So by adding in the characters' personalities, other goals that they have in mind from this, whether it's connecting with a partner or, you know, some social thing, then, yeah, by adding in other conflicts to it, then you can make it a good story as opposed to just, you know, retelling the same story one more time.
Agreed. That also brings us to an interesting angle on this genre of fiction, because you could easily call it simply pandering. And we have a little discussion on pandering that we can have as well, because people don't always consider the fact that there are many kinds of pandering. When we were talking about this in Skype and preparing for the panel and getting familiar with it, not getting familiar with it that way, pretty much.
I'm married.
She's married. We were talking about pandering, because it's easy to assume that anything in the genre that we're working in is nothing but pandering. And there are many kinds of panderings, and the fic My Little Dashie came up in the discussion. And we're not saying this is a bad fic, but we're saying that to an extent it is the emotionally pandering fic, because it is going for the feels in an expert way, very effectively, no holds barred. And the thing about it that makes it similar to our genre is that, well, our genre in some senses of using it, is My Little Dashie tends to do a thing about making readers see themselves as deeply caring individuals without actually requiring that they do anything to be deeply caring individuals other than have a lot of feels. This is pandering. This is pandering. It's setting up a fic where the reader can vent their emotions, and they haven't paid anything for it. The character that they are identifying with is just wonderful and sweet and suffers a terrible loss, and lonely bronies can understand being connected in this way and feeling a loss and such. So it's a pretty direct, basic fic.